So again, welcome to this first live webinar of ACG Holland. Before I introduce our speakers, I would like to tell you a little bit about ACG. So for those of the guests that are present, ACG is a global network of more than 14,000 members that work together on M&A deals. ACG Holland, we have 200 members. Normally, we organize around 10 networking events, physical events, but as this is not possible, this is your first ACG Holland webinar. We are a non-profit organization, and only for €300 you can join our community. So feel free to reach out if you want to know more. Our contact details will be at the end of this webinar. A special thank you, of course, to our sponsors, which you can see here on this slide. And of course, also thanks to all the members and the guests. We will be discussing open source software and risk associated, especially to M&A deals. So to give a good distinction on, let's say, software, which is currently in M&A deals, always a subject. We won't be looking at the paid for software like Microsoft Office, for example, which you pay for and use. But we will be looking at the open source software, which is free of charge. But although it's free of charge, it comes with a responsibility and potential risk within the M&A environment. So with further ado, let me introduce our speakers of today. First of all, we will have Pascal van Eck. He's software senior consultant at Software Improvement Group. And next to software engineering, Pascal has a keen interest in the legal aspects of his profession for many years, especially copyright and intellectual property. His talk will take around 10 minutes, and after Pascal, Harold Jongen will be speaking. And Harold is advocaat and partner at Greenberg Traurig, our brand new sponsor of ACG Holland. And already has 25 years of M&A experience and IT and outsourcing. And we've worked already on a couple of transactions together. And this is something that we will be discussing in the rest of this webinar. So without further ado, Pascal.
Thank you, Eddie. And welcome to all of the participants in this webinar. Before I jump into the topic of open source software, I would first like to say a few things about the Software Improvement Group. So we are a consultancy firm specializing on software quality. We are about 150 persons, mainly in Amsterdam, but active in Europe, North America, and Asia. And one thing we find important is our independence. So the way we work is through source code analysis. We firmly believe at SIG that if you want to know the truth about software, the place to look is the source code, because that's in the end where it all starts and where what the computers are actually doing. So our core competence is analyzing computer source code. We can do that for some 300 programming languages. We've been doing that for a while, and currently we have a data warehouse with measurement results for about 30 billion lines of source code. And so what we do with that is giving advisory services. So we want to turn the findings that we found in the source code into actionable advice in many contexts, one of which is IT due diligences, which we have already done over 130. So with this background, we are ready to jump into today's topic. And there are three things that I want you to remember after this talk. And the first one is that uses of open source software is completely accepted. It's beneficial, and in some areas it's even unavoidable. And I'll give concrete examples in the next slide. It's beneficial, it's a good thing, but like anything that has value in life, it comes with a cost. And the cost is that you need to keep those open source third party building blocks up to date. And I'll give an example of what could happen if you don't. So the consequence of that is that while beneficial, using open source software involves risks. And that's why, the third point, we firmly believe that in any IT due diligence, one of the things that needs to be addressed is an assessment of those risks. And I'll elaborate on that a little bit more in my final slide. Next slide, please. So, usage of open source building blocks is nowadays a totally accepted practice. As a concrete example, I'm mentioning here a component called GW Player. It's a piece of software source code that allows you to display videos on a web page. And that's functionality that you often want. Think of web shops, think of social media platforms. Even just a company presentation web page could have that functionality. And no programmer in his or her right mind these days would try to make such a thing by themselves. There's this component called GW Player as just an example that's perfectly well for that. We had a quick look at it. It saves you at least 3 person years of work. And that's why using open source building blocks is these days a accepted and even beneficial practice. You simply become more productive. So I already said, in certain areas, it's even unavoidable these days. Take business applications. There are two leading building blocks to make them for those with a technical background. I'm talking about Microsoft's .NET framework and Oracle's Java programming languages. I think together they constitute at least 80% of all modern business applications for several years now. Both are open source. In the area of web-based user interfaces, which is the dominant user interface these days, it's even more prominent. All popular building blocks, I'm talking about React, Angular, Vue, they are all open source. So to drive the point home, suppose that you would still avoid using open source libraries. That would lead to unnecessary costs. It will give you an unappealing labor market position. And because of the closedness of non-open source, it will lead to extra vendor lock-in that you don't want. So because of all this, I consider it beneficial, but it comes with a risk. And to provide you with an example of that, I'm mentioning here the case of Equifax. They are an American company specializing in, let's say, credit profiles. So they know a lot of personal details about financial position, in this case of at least 143 million people. For their website, they used a framework called Struts. There's nothing wrong with Struts. It's an accepted framework for that. But like in most software, at some point in time, a security vulnerability was discovered. That happened on March 7th, 2017. What they should have done is they should have a policy in place in which you monitor certain websites. That, for instance, the one of the manufacturers of Struts that say things like, sorry, we discovered a security vulnerability, you need to upgrade to at least version 2.3.32. But at Equifax, they didn't. They kept on using a quite outdated version of the Struts library. At one point in time, we don't know exactly when, hackers found out too, exploited this security vulnerability, and the rest is history, as they say. It led to a data leak in which potentially the financial details of 143 million people were leaked to who knows whom. So I think that this example clearly illustrates the price that you have to pay. You have to keep all the components that you are using up to date. So next slide, please. That brings us to IT due diligences. So we think that as part of any IT due diligence, You need to assess the risks of using third-party building blocks. Not because it's a bad thing to do, to the contrary, it's beneficial, it's even unavoidable in some areas, but simply to check if the risks associated with it are managed correctly. So how we do that at SIG is, once we are involved, we run our tools over the source code of the target in question, making an inventory of all open source software building blocks that are being used. And we look for three things. And the first and most important one is, are there any known security vulnerabilities in the building blocks currently in use? The second one is, which copyright licenses are being used, because not all are equal, and you need an inventory of that as well. And last but not least, what is the freshness? And with that we mean, are building blocks up to date? Are the latest versions being used? And if not, are they far behind, years? Or just something like a month or a few weeks, that's not so bad. So we at SIG are very good at making such an inventory and figuring out which open source building blocks are being used. But what we've learned is that to do a good assessment in the context of an IT due diligence, you need help of other people because it's necessarily multidisciplinary. IT professionals have the means and the knowledge to make an inventory, but making sense of those open source licenses, that's not a technical topic, it's purely a legal one. And so that's why we often work together with legal professionals, and I'm very happy that we have one of them, Harald Jongen, as our next speaker. Harald, the floor is yours.
Yes, thank you very much, Pascal. We are going to the legal aspects and risks now, indeed. First, 10 seconds about GT. We are a law firm. I'm an advocate, law firm with more than 2,000 lawyers, American origin, in 41 offices all over the world. And in Amsterdam, we are at the Leidseplein, above the Apple shop, talking about technology with 50 lawyers, tax lawyers and civil notaries. So what is the main risk? Let me give you a sneak preview before I lose you. The main risk is a loss of value of the target. And that is, of course, equally important for buyers as well as sellers. And why is that? We're going to explain that in a second. Let's take the following use case. The value of the target company depends on intellectual property rights, IPR, and usually if we're talking about software, that will be copyright on software. And then, of course, the relevant question for the deal is, for the buyers and the sellers, does the target own this IPR? We will find that out through due diligence, as Pascal just mentioned, and Greenberg Traurig will do that in a slightly different way than you may be used to. What we namely do is sit down, if possible, on day one to interview senior management of the company. And that interview will be done by a very, very senior lawyer who knows the business and who knows exactly the issues at hand. That could be myself or a very senior associate. So that means that no herds of juniors will jump in a data room and start reading thousands of documents, but we will focus on that interview. And we will do that in cooperation with SIG. What will we ask in those interviews? Well, we have basically a couple of pretty simple questions. And the first question is, do you have or do you use open software? Now, if the answer to that question is no, all alarm bells will go off, because that usually means that the company does not really know what they're doing and what they're facing, because as Pascal just explained, and also Eddie, there is open source software in basically any company. The next question would be, do you have an open source policy? A policy is a document which contains some rules and guidelines how to deal with open source software. Relevant question in that respect is also, do you train your people, or is it a policy that nobody ever read? Do you regularly, frequently train them, yes or no? And then the last question, main question, would be, do you have an inventory of the open source that you use? That inventory may be available. If the answer is yes, we do, the target may have it. And if the answer is no, or we have a very old one, which we made 3 years ago, never updated it, it can be made with a scan of the source code, as Pascal just explained, and SIG can, of course, then help. Now, the next step, and now it gets important, is that we are going to map that inventory against the main classification of open source software. Now, you should realize there's many, many, many open source software products. There's many, many licenses, more than 1,400. But the three main categories are the following. The first one is what is called the share alike or copyleft, strong copyleft, or the viral open source software. And the best example of that, the most well-known example, is the GPL license. And as you can see, there is a red high risk of loss of IPR there in that box. And I will explain in a second why that is. That's the main, first main category. The second main category is the keep open, or also called the weak copyleft OSS. And a good example is the Mozilla public license. Now you see there that the risk is of usage of that open source software in your company in the target is low to none if the use is compliant with the license terms, and we will get to that in a second. The third category is the free for all OSS, open source software. Three examples are MIT, Apache, and Berkeley, and also there the risk is low. Now, why is the risk for the strong copyleft or the viral OSS high? That is basically a pretty simple matter. In any copyleft OSS, there is an obligation to contribute back the improvements that you make in the source code. So you can use the source code, you can improve it, but you have to return that to the OSS community, to the world, for everyone to use. That's the basic idea of this kind of open source software. Now, in strong copyleft software terms like GPL, there is one big issue, and that is that you may also have to contribute back to the community, to the public domain, the product in which these improvements were incorporated. And what does that now mean if you have to do that? If the target incorporates improvements in its own custom built source code, so they have a nice idea, they developed a source code, but in there they included the copyleft GPL kind of OSS, then there is a high risk, depending on the facts and the circumstances, but there is a high risk that the entire improved source code must be brought in the public domain free of charge. So what does that mean? Gone is the value of the asset, the target. Back on slide one, there you go. Because you thought that the target had a nice IPR in a fantastic source code, but they have an obligation to give that to the world free of charge. Now, this will not always be the case if you use GPL, but then it gets very technical, both IT-wise and legal, but this is the main risk. By the way, on the right-hand side, you see that strange sign that is an inverted copyright sign, and it is a bit of a wordplay, copyleft, copyright, copyleft. That was created by the open source community. So this is the sign on the right-hand side for the copyleft. So if you see that, be aware. For the lawyers who are participating, there's a couple I see among the 60, 70 of you that are in the webinar. The target will still own the copyright, but this is more or less empty. given that the OSS license applies, which means that it has to be given the product free of charge to basically the world, anyone who wants to use it. Now, is this a high risk in M&A transactions only? No. Of course, you should continuously monitor whether you have any open source. If you buy or sell a company 2 years later, it's still a relevant question whether you use OSS and which OSS it is. There are tools to do that. That's basically the policy, the inventory, keep it up to date, do frequent scans maybe, and do a frequent analysis after you've done all that, you've done the scans, and you dive into the detail where Sig and Greenberg Traurig could do that together and help you. There's also some other risks of open source software. That is, namely, you should comply with the license terms. And as I said before, there's more than 1,400 of those. So the devil is in the detail. And if you don't comply, you may have a problem that you infringe the copyright and that your license terminates. There's also some security risk. Pascal just gave the example of Equifax. But let's not forget, we talk about risk, risk, risk. Open source software, that's how we start, is a very, very positive thing for the world. It has great benefits, great improvements, but it should be used with care. Thank you.
Thank you, Harold. And with that, we conclude our webinar. So a quick recap. As we discussed today, software is in the heart of many M&A deals nowadays. And I think by asking simple questions, as Harold stated, even do you have an OSS inventory? If there is a no or I don't know, then indeed all alarm bells will go off. And if there's a yes, then there's still a need for you to check whether it's complete and accurate, and you don't run any risks that we've been discussing in this webinar. And of course, this can be revealed in a due diligence type of setting, but of course, what you would like to do, and this will be a topic for the years to come, is to have a continuous exercise in keeping the open source up to date, as we've discussed. Otherwise, you might potentially lose value within your company. And a third, after the really hard facts that we as, that SIG has IT diligence and of course, Greenberg Traurig with their legal view, looking for hard evidence. Of course, there's an additional value if you bring different DD streams together, like legal and IT, for example, in this case, because there is a lot of extra value to be gained. We will talk to different people within the company with the interviews that we do. And you might align those results in the stream and therefore adding a lot of additional value to the investor in getting more security about what kind of investments they are stepping into. So with that, I would like to open it up for Q&A. So let me see if there are any questions coming in. Bear with me 1 second. Yes, so we have here a first question. It's actually addressed to Harold. So Harold, if in the due diligence you find that copyleft licenses are being used, is this always a deal breaker?
No, it's not always a deal breaker. As I said, you need to then dive into the detail, which open source license applies, what exactly has been done with that open source software. Is it now included in the source code or is it just linked? Is it dynamic linking, static linking? That it gets very, very technical. But the problem is that there is always a risk involved that you need to, assess and, if possible, mitigate. So what we jointly, Sig and Greenberg, quite often advise, if we find a copyleft license, look for an alternative which does basically the same in the open source community. Look for an alternative soft OSS, which is not copyleft. And quite often that is available. SIG will know when that is the case usually, and they can help and can say, okay, just take instead of the GPL OSS for this functionality, something else. And then the risk is basically gone. Maybe you will need to make tweaks in the source code, but that's the way forward.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Harold. We have some additional questions coming in. Do SIG and or Greenberg Traubrich also have experience with helping companies to create a OSS policy? And how does one go about that? Any examples? I'm not sure. Pascal, is that something for you? Harold?
Yes. Thank you, Eddie. Certainly, this is a topic that often comes up outside of our due diligences, where our customers are asking us, "Hey, we are seeing some findings that we find that are worrying us. So you are telling us that we are not up to date with our open source components. What would be the best practices to manage those a little bit better?" And then we investigate what's the situation, and we give advice from the technical side. And Harold, maybe you can add something from your profession.
Sure, Pascal. Yes, it's something we help with. We've written quite a lot of, or co-written quite a lot of open source policies, and gave advice how to do it, what they should tackle, what should be in them. Also here, it can be a joint effort because we will look a little bit less at technology and a little bit more at legal. So SIG would do the opposite. But there is advice possible. Also, by the way, on the internet, you can find, of course, guidance on how to do it, and you can find some policies that you can check.
All right, thank you for that. Another probably question for you, Harold. One question from the audience: is it possible to repair the situation if a hard copy left is incorporated in the source code?
Yes, it is. It's basically an element of the first question. So if you find, rephrase that. It depends on the situation. If you are in breach already, and you should have distributed the entire product to the community, then you have an issue. Because they could claim that you actually do that. They could claim performance of the license, nakoming in Dutch, saying, hey, this was the were the conditions, and the condition is that you contribute the product to the community. So hopefully, if you're in that situation, nobody will have noticed. And then there is no claim because nobody knows about it. And then you can, behind the scenes and the screens, quickly try to repair the situation by looking for alternatives, taking all that OSS out that you used, putting other in, or create your own code. However, this is a lot of work. And what we see in M&A transactions is, as soon as this risk is perceived that it has a effect, as I said, on the price, or at least it delays the transaction. There's a very good example that IBM bought a company a couple of years ago, and they found with a simple scan and in 2 hours that there were 80 open source software elements in there, and they reduced the price with 30 million, which was 30% of the purchase price in this example. But yes, I think it was Anneke who asked the question. It is possible, but it can be complicated.
All right, thank you, Harold. We'll have one last question. I know there are more questions coming in, but we will make sure that we will address those after the session, so you will not be forgotten. This last question is for Pascal. So if your due diligence uncovers old version of open source software being used, can and will SIG also further investigate if any known or unknown vulnerabilities have been exploited?
We do that. Often via the angle of privacy. So what we can also see in source code is, how are you dealing with, for instance, personal data? Is it all over the place, or is it nicely isolated? Now, suppose that we also find that you're using a building block with a known vulnerability. Via that angle, we can see what the potential impact could be. And so that's how we approach this this problem. I would say that in the context of an IT due diligence, it's it's often more black and white. I recall the last one that I was involved in where we actually found something that made us call the target immediately. It was of the level of drop your pencil, stop whatever you're doing right now, fix it. And only after that, we'll talk about what the consequences are for the deal.
All right. Thank you very much, Pascal. Thanks, Harold, for your views on open source and how it's used in a M&A environment. I would like to thank you all for joining this this webinar. Again, it is already recorded. We will provide you with a link to review it. And if there are any questions left, you can also address them directly to the presenters that have been talking, showing you the email addresses for a couple of minutes. And with that, wish you a very nice day. Stay safe and hope to see you soon at a physical ACG event after the summer holidays. Thank you very much.